midst of the fire that we're experiencing on the outside, that we'll experience your joy and your peace and your love and faith in Christ in this place. Father, meet with us. Transform us. Revive us. Renew us. Have your way with us. For we ask that in the wonderful name of your Son, our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. And together we say, Amen.
I'm Jan Lowe, Minister of Congregational Care. I want to welcome everyone this morning. If you're a member, if you're a guest, we just are so glad that you're here. If you are a guest with us for the first time today, we have something we'd like to share with you. We need your help to make that happen. Before you leave here this morning, when you go out into the narthex, if you will stop at the desk there and just give us your name and address. When we have that, later this week, someone will stop by your home. They will drop off a mug that is yours to keep, but that mug is going to have information in it that tells about the many ministries and the many ways that we have in this church to serve our Lord and to serve people in our community and beyond, and to serve one another. I hope that sounds good to you. In the meantime, we ask that everyone enjoy the fellowship that is here today. I want to say a special welcome to the people that are watching on the television stations or over the internet. We are so glad to have our congregation expanded by your presence with us, and we thank you for that. We do have attendance pads. I believe they've been passed. If someone new has come into the row that you're in, pass them one more time. When we see your name, it tells us that you were here, but it also helps us figure out who might not have been able to be here this morning. When we have that information, we can do a better job of staying in touch with our church family. So thanks for helping us with that. If you will open your bulletins to ministry opportunities and events, there are just lots and lots of things that are going on. I'm going to go through a few of them quickly. I'll start on the back page with Supercharged. Supercharged, believe it or not, is coming up this Friday. There is so much going on, so much that's going to be available, especially for our youth that are going back to school. And you have an opportunity to help in a number of different ways. One, you can volunteer to be there and help. Two, you can volunteer just to come and have fun. And we also would like to invite you that if you are able to provide some school supplies, there is a missions table out this door here, right behind the sanctuary. And we are collecting school supplies. So if you can bring school supplies between now and Friday morning, we will turn around and give those school supplies to children at this event on Friday. So please read it thoroughly and see what's going on and plan to attend that event on Friday. The youth today want to say thank you to the entire congregation. They do feel very blessed that the church has supported them so much. When they went on their summer trip, they had many experiences. They'd like to share some of those experiences with you. So today, following the third service in Becker Hall, there's going to be a light lunch served, so please come back and just listen to the kids as they tell you about the experiences they had, and that is their way of saying thank you to the whole congregation. We have Karina Dove, who is a missionary in Thailand. She is here for most of August, and she is going to be here in our church on Tuesday. She will be preparing a Thai lunch that will be served at noon. We need you to call the office and let us know if you're planning to attend, just so enough food can be prepared. She has a story to tell. Come and hear her story at noon this Tuesday. The United Methodist Men is meeting this Wednesday at 6:30 in Becker Hall. Men, if you have not yet made your arrangements to be there, or if you need to make any kind of a change, please contact Jim Belkoff. His phone number is listed here before the end of the day today to make those plans. Last thing I want to say quickly is that Pack-A-Sack, which is coming up next Sunday. Read the things in Pack-A-Sack. This is a special collection. It's for the children that are going back to school, and they collect special kinds of things. So read the things that they're needing and bring those with you when you come to church next Sunday morning. God bless, and thank you.
please remain standing and join with me in our call to worship. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who makes in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. And that's what we're talking about today, about how God is with us, even in the midst of fire trials. The very fourth verse of our hymn we sung, How Firm a Foundation, is basically the message of the sermon. So there's the Cliff Notes version. You can check out during sermon time if you want to. Or either what I really wish is that you would engage and that you would see the words from this hymn come alive in your heart through the power of the Holy Spirit. We're glad that all of you are here. We welcome you. Will you greet those around you and help us to make sure everyone is made to feel welcome in God's house today.
Wow. The scripture this morning is only 8 words long. It's short but powerful. It's Paul explaining why the Lord does not have to be physically present in our lives. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7 from the New International Version. Listen to the word of God. For we live by faith, not by sight. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
As the ushers come forward, may we reflect on the faithfulness of our God and the faith that God inspires in us. May we give back our tithes and our offerings, knowing that every dollar, from one to many, is an act of praise and worship to our God. Faithful and loving God, from morning to evening, from waking to sleeping, you inspire faith in us, for you are everlasting to everlasting. You are faithful in all things. We humbly give back these, our gifts, to you, and we pray that you will use them to build your kingdom and for your glory. We pray in your Son's name, our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. We have come now to the time that we share in the joys and the concerns of our church family. We do have joys. There was a little rain amidst the heat. Our lawns are still green, and it's almost the middle of August. Can that really be? It's hard to believe. Nita May is still in Highlands, but doing better. And this morning at the 9:30 service, we are going to live stream, and she will be able to see that live stream this morning. Arrangements have been made for that to happen. So we are thankful for that. Lots of things are happening in our church in the month of August. It's not the dregs of summer, but there is life going on here at First United Methodist Church. Jan told you about a number of those things, but I want to mention one more. Starting Monday the 17th, a grief support group will be held, starting at 5:30, going from 5:30 to 7. It goes from August the 17th until October the 26th, and those dates are strategically chosen, and is the time, with the hope that we will always be done before it gets dark, in case there are those who would like to be a part of this group, but do not drive well after dark. So keep that in mind if you're considering it. Please, if you are experiencing grief, it does not matter whether it has been a month or 10 years. If you are still journeying through your grief and you would like to go through that journey with others, we invite you to come be a part of this group, and do hope that you will prayerfully consider being a part of that group. So please know that all are welcome. We have a joy in that Roy Tennell is with us this morning. We've lost Levita, but we are glad that he is able to be with us this morning in this difficult time. The white carnation on the altar is in memory of Carol Pryor. His service will be this coming Friday, the 14th at 1 p.m. And we ask you to continue to lift up Juanita and their family in your prayers. Also, Jack Hunter's service was held this past Friday, and there were many of you. Last Saturday. And I know that there were many of you were there and continue to lift his family up in prayer. Pastor Judy is not with us today because she has had a death in her family. Her husband's uncle passed away, and they traveled to Memphis to be with family, and Dixon led the service as well. Emma Rose Jennings is still in Highlands, not doing well. We ask you to continue to keep her in prayer and her family in prayer as well. And Jesse Bradley was taken to the hospital within the weekend, and she is in Mercy at this time, doing a little better than when she was taken there, but still in the hospital. So please keep Jesse in your prayers as well. And the church that we ask that you lift up this week is Bella Vista Assembly of God. Lift up the pastors, the congregation, and the ministries that they provide in the Bella Vista area. And now, as we prepare to go to God in prayer, please join with me in the prayer song.
Thank you.
Provider God, you have been faithful to us in the past. You are faithful today. And your faithfulness will be with us into the future. Your love for us never fails. Forgive our unfaithfulness, Lord. Forgive us when we place our faith and trust only in things we can see, in money, in possessions, in jobs, in our own abilities, or in the abilities of others. Forgive us when we fail to see that you are our great provider. All things come from you. We ask that you grant us faith and trust in you, for in you all things are possible. Lord, we know that you are present with us in times of joy and in times of struggles and sorrows. Lord, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for the vitality of the ministries here at Bella Vista First. We give you thanks for the continuing recovery of Nita May. Lord, we ask for your healing touch to be upon Jesse Bradley, upon Juanita Pryor and her family, and upon Emma Rose Jennings, and to be on others who are experiencing illness and loss at this time. Help us to live, Lord, with our eyes on you. Even when our paths are dark, you are ever with us, providing light and comfort in the darkness. Help us to live knowing that you are our shepherd. Lord, you provide green pastures and quiet waters to still our souls. You make our tables bountiful and our cups to overflow. Give us the faith to trust you, that we may have hearts of humble gratitude for your love and your faithfulness. We pray that you send your Holy Spirit to rest upon Brother Jaimie. As he delivers your message, may his words be your words. May they inspire us to your ways, your truth, and your light. Lord, we lift these prayers and all the unspoken prayers of our hearts to you this day as we join together in the prayer which our Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I want to share with you two great words of opportunity for us. One is, we are going to have a baptism service next Sunday afternoon at 5 p.m. It's at Lake Avalon, and you're invited to participate in that. We have adults that are requesting baptism, four adults right now, and maybe you feel led if you have become a part of this church family and you've never been baptized or joined the church to be baptized. I'd love to visit with you during the week and as we prepare for this coming Sunday. And so, and we'd also love for you to come and to share in the blessing and the witness of that time. And so that's next Sunday evening at 5 p.m. at Lake Avalon. And the other opportunity we have just has come about this week, and that is next week on Wednesday, we are going to host the Cooper Elementary faculty and staff here as they begin their school year together. It's our opportunity to provide them lunch one day in which they come to the building. Lunch will be served between 11 and 11:15, and then they'll be gone by 12:30. But we need some help being greeters and serving at the tables and being the face of the church for the persons that will be visiting with us. If you would like to do that, if you'll let us know that, we'd appreciate it. You can contact the office, Janet Walton in the office, or you can just show up and we'll put you to work in any way, shape, or form. Well, this is time of year that we look forward to in hearing about the ministry of Gideon's International. Gideon's is such a vital ministry that is worldwide. We're blessed today to have Chuck Class, one of our area Gideons, and he is supported this morning by a Gideon from our own congregation, Lee Moore. And Chuck will come and share with you about the Gideon ministry. And then following the service, you will have an opportunity to make your investment in what is taking place through the ministry of the Gideons and through the sharing of God's holy word. Chuck, you're invited.
Good morning. You probably all heard of the Pony Express, the mail being delivered by horse in the 1800s, but you probably didn't know that the riders were no more than 17 years old, they all carried a Bible, and none were lost. That's a brief description of the Gideon ministry. We would that worldwide everyone would have a Bible and no one would be lost. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Gary Linton told me he received a testament in the fifth grade down in Florida. He took it home, put it away in a dresser drawer, and time went on. When he was 17, he had a problem, a serious problem. He was home 57 days from school, either drunk or in a stupor from drugs. He decided something had to change, and he remembered back that his teacher generally had a thought for the day. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He remembered that testament, brought it out, and started to study. And he studied and read, and he met the Lord Jesus Christ. His problems went away. He went back to school. He was able to preach during the lunch hour, and the administration thought that was just fine. I wish it was more fine in some of our states around the country. The Gideons have distributed over 2 billion testaments in the last over 100 years. And the third world countries aren't able to afford the testaments. So 80% of those have been financed by the United States. And periodically we have Bible blitzes in these countries. The latest one was down in Chile. And schools are open. The military, the hospitals, the hotels, they're all open. They accept a gospel message also. And 523,000 testaments were given out in Chile. And we see that thousands are coming to the Lord Jesus Christ because we're able to make these distributions in schools in these third world countries in particular. We appreciate so much the response that we've had from this congregation in the past. You've been a partner with us in this ministry. And that has been a blessing. And I just thank you so much. And we pray that you might also pray for the ministry. Thank you so much for your kind attention this morning. And I will be out in the back if you have questions and would like to talk to me. Thank you.
Chuck, I've told this story before of going to Chile almost 20 years ago. And there I met a young lady, and she wanted to know if I was a Gideon. And I said, no, I'm not. I'm a pastor, and so I'm not a Gideon. She said, well, then I'm not interested in you, and no, in certain terms. Because she wanted to marry a Gideon. And that was her goal, was to marry a Gideon.
Well, we had a student from the University of Arkansas that gave her testament to us. And the one thing she said is, when I get married, it has to be a Gideon.
We are ending today our four-part sermon series called More Than a Campfire Story, Stories That Change Life. And next week, we'll begin a new sermon series. In fact, it's a seven-part sermon series, and it's simply called Seven. And in that sermon series, we're gonna look at the seven deadly sins versus the seven heavenly virtues. And at some point in time in that sermon series, I bet you're going to feel like you were kicked in your shins, or hopefully not every Sunday, but somewhere along the lines, you're going to find yourself in one of these areas. And I hope that this next sermon series will be of a great benefit to you and of the development of your faith and allowing Christ through his presence to work a wonderful work in your life of healing and of relief from one of these areas of issues. But today, we are looking at a story that I love. And this is a story that's been told and retold and told again throughout our lives. I heard this story as a little child. It wasn't around the campfire, though. It was in church. It was in Sunday school. And I heard about these three incredible men and about a fourth man that appeared with them and about the king's response of what was taking place. And all this took place in these three gentlemen's lives, took place under fire. And they had such incredible bravery to face the fire. So we're going to talk about that story. How many of you have a pop-up toaster? I've always been mesmerized by pop-up toasters. That's about the level of my intelligence. You know, that you can put the bread in there or a Pop-Tart or whatever, and you press that button down, and then you can go about your business, or you can stare at the toaster like I've been known to do. And at the right time, you know, the bread pops up. But it doesn't always pop up at the right time, does it? I really don't like it when the bread pops up and it's not the level of toast that I want it to be. And so you re-toast it, and then you worry. Is it going to be too brown? Is it going to catch on fire? What's going to happen? And you look and you wonder, and it pops up. And oftentimes it's just the way I want it. You know, people, we've all got stories about pop-up toasters and how they worked or they didn't work. But it's just amazing how you just put a little pressure on it, the fire comes, the bread is toasted, it comes up, and it's how it's supposed to be. And sometimes in life, that's how life gets. You and I can feel like we're bread in a pop-up toaster. You know, there's heat in circumstances. There's adverse fire that we're faced in life. We just want to pop up and pop out of the situation. But that's not always the best. I mean, if we will let a difficult situation work its ultimate conclusion, in which we pop up and we pop out of it, we'll discover that God has done something in us. It may have been a very difficult time because of the pressure of the heat, but in the end we'll discover that there's something that God would allow us to discover about ourselves, about faith, that we could discover so much more about the presence of the Lord in our life. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about some men that were put into literally a pop-up toaster. And the fire was hot. But ultimately they popped out and they survived. Now these three men are called, their names are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I love those names, though I'm grateful my mother did not name me those. And we read about the three men in Daniel. And so I invite you to take out your Bibles or your few Bibles and follow along with me this morning as we read from Daniel, the third chapter. We're reading verses 19 through 27. And this is part of the account of what has taken place. And then Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And that's because they would not bow to the golden idol that he had required them to bow down to. And his attitude toward them changed. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in the army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into a blazing furnace. So these men, wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. And the king's command was so urgent that the furnace was so hot that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. And then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, "Weren't there three men that were tied up and thrown into the fire?" They replied, "Oh, certainly, O king." And he said, "Look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound, unharmed, and the fourth looks like the son of the gods." And Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace, and he shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire. And the satraps and the prefects and the governors and the royal advisors crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was their hair or their robes singed, and their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I love that story. An amazing faith-building, faith-encountering story. And as we've talked about in the sermon series, people for generations have always stood around the fires and told stories. But people don't only tell stories around fires, they tell stories in their lives at all times. You know, stories around the fire possibly may be get to these stories of survival and success. Stories of battles that you've been in and that you've gone through and that you've come out on the other side. Battles where you thought you weren't going to succeed, but ultimately you hung on and you hung on to God and you hung on to your faith in Christ and you survived. I'm in a privileged position where I hear stories. And I hear stories called testimonies or witnesses of how people have made it through. And when I'm out in the public, and sometimes you like to admit to your preacher, because sometimes you don't, because when you do admit to it, people always act real funny around you. And you like to see people act normal. But it's really fun when you're in a group of people that they're strangers to you at the beginning, but suddenly you become friends. And this can happen on an airplane, an airport, and a line or something. They begin to tell their stories of how they survived the fires of life. I bet you've told some stories about how you've survived the fires of life too. You've told them at the beauty shop or the barber shop. Or you've told them in small group situations, or you've been waiting in a doctor's office waiting room and you struck up a conversation with someone, or maybe at a hospital. Places where fire is real. And that story that you have can engage someone else to understanding that as they remain faithful to a God who's faithful, they will ultimately come out on the other side better. You know, today's technology world, those stories are shared in any number of ways. Through Facebook, Snapchat, Twitter, all kinds of ways that people are telling their stories. And these fires are called the fires of relationships, or the fires of health, or the fires of financial concerns, or the fires that take place between family members, or the fires that take place at work, or the fires are related to political discussions or distress. And the fires come about in so many ways. And fires are not, a fire is never really a comfortable situation when you're involved in it, is it? Well, the account of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is about three young men who find themselves in the midst of a fire. They find themselves in a time in which they do not know, they do not do something that a king wants them to do. And when they remain faithful to God, rather than bowing to the idol that the king has asked them to bow down to, they find themselves in a time of adversity. Now, here's what has happened. Let's get a little background knowledge. Daniel, we know he had found his place in the kingdom. He is a prophet of God. He's found favor with King Nebuchadnezzar. And so he promotes three men, these three that we've read about, that we know about, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, to King Nebuchadnezzar. He really believes that they have a great place of importance in the kingdom. And so King Nebuchadnezzar, he places them as administrators over Babylon. And then he has this huge image of gold, an idol, cast and built. It's 90 by 9, and it's placed in the province of Babylon. Now, when it is time to dedicate the idol, he calls all the officials to come forward, all the persons of significance in the kingdom, and others to come there for the dedication. And what he commands them to do is at the sound of a various sound of music, they're supposed to bow down and worship immediately this idol. And the music is sounded, and people hit the floor. They do as they're required. They're afraid of the king. That is, all except three. These three men. King finds out about it. King Nebuchadnezzar, he is so furious with these three that they would not obey his decree. And so he approaches them. And they are determined. And they experience the king in a way they've not experienced him before when they tell him, we will not bow down because we serve the Most High God. And we will only bow to God, not to your idol. Well, this enrages Nebuchadnezzar, that these three would be so bold and so brazen against his order. So he orders that they would be destroyed. And what is a really treacherous way to destroy these three? That is to have them burned. See, so he orders the furnace heated 7 times harder than usual. The scripture tells us he calls forth the strongest of the soldiers. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are caught. They are tied, they are bound together, and they are thrown into the fire. Now, when they are thrown into the fire, they are thrown in the fire with the wisdom from their heart and from their faith to the king. And that is, we serve a Most High God, and you can throw us into the fire, but we know that our God will be with us. We know that he's present. So whatever you choose to do to us, just know, we know our God. And they're thrown into the fire. And in the midst of the fire, God is present. In the midst of the fire, God is there. In the midst of the fire, God is doing a work beyond what Nebuchadnezzar could have ever imagined. So that when Nebuchadnezzar looks into the midst of the fire through the opening of the furnace, he sees Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. No longer are they tied. No longer are they bound. But they're walking around freely. And not only are the three walking around freely, but he sees the fourth person in the fire. And he says, it looks like the son of the gods, because God is with them in the fire. And so he orders that they would be released, and they are released, and they come out. They pop out of that fire like toast out of a pop-up toaster. And they're not harmed. Their hair is not singed. They don't even smell like smoke. And you know what? King Nebuchadnezzar is so impressed by their determined, devoted faith that would not even be deterred when they were facing the adversary of the fire, that he ordered that no one could say a word against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. No one could speak a word of blasphemy. No one. And the fire that they experienced ultimately revealed that Nebuchadnezzar himself was going through a fire. And he was discovered that he too had a God that was present and was real and was with him even though he was so unaware of it. No, in life we face fires. You have your own version of a fiery furnace that you've had to endure, that you've faced. The fire of depression, the fire of an abusive relationship, the fires of dangers related to sin, the fires of prejudice, the fires of health and concerns, the fires of grief, the fires of difficulties, the list of our fires that we experience as individuals living life is almost an endless list of fires that we face. And sometimes, in fact, oftentimes, times under fire seems seven times worse than anything we've experienced in life. It just seems so difficult. You know when you're experiencing a fire, you know how hard life can seem. You have questions of why and what if and what should I do next and how can I endure and why do I have to wait and this whole patience thing. Fires in life are difficult. You know, trials when we're in a fire, a really fiery trial in life, it can seem seven times harder than any of the trials we faced before. Or stress. When we're in stress because of a fire of life, this type of stress can have such debilitating abuses in our life. It can seem so incredibly seven times harder than any other stress we've dealt with before. And you and I can either let the fire consume us. We can let the fire of that situation, of that adverse situation, consume us. Or we can let it refine us. And we have to make that choice. And it is through holding on to the faith in our God that we ultimately choose refinement. We choose to survive. We choose to make even the most hot, heated situation a place of change for us in our heart and a development of our faith in Christ. Because even in a process of refinement, that refining time can bring out the best in us, even in the worst of times. If we will allow it to do that, it can bring us out. You know, when we're building our physical bodies, we like to see development take place. And so when you exercise or you do cardiovascular exercise or you lift weights or you walk or you do whatever you do and swim, you like to feel that you made an investment in this physical development. You like to feel that. And workouts, they involve effort, and they involve sweat, and they involve heavy breathing, and sometimes they involve sore muscles. But you get something out of it, because there's something that's taking place within you, because you're doing something on the outside. And that's what God does with the fires in our life. God can put us in these workout situations where, though the workout may be so difficult, the key is that it will work out because of our faith in God, because of our faith in Christ, knowing that God is present with us. He will not forsake us. That's why the verse that Ed read is so important. See, though we may not physically see, our faith sees spiritually. And we know that God is with us and that we will experience ultimate blessing in the end. You know, there's a guy who once came into the gym, and maybe you've seen these kind of people. Decide they're going to work out. So they show up for the workout, and they're dressed, you know, in the shorts, T-shirt, maybe a headband, sweatband, always a bottle of water. And he did his stretching exercises. And did all those things, bent, and was just kind of an obnoxious distraction in the gym. And then he went over, and he lifted 2 5-pound dumbbells. About 3 times. He put them down. He had his towel, so he wiped the sweat off his brow, and he said, "Whew, I guess I'm done with that. I'm worked out." Now, that's not a real workout, is it? A workout requires some determination, some dedication to the workout, a knowledge that in order for the workout to have the best benefit, you have to invest yourself in it completely. Well, that's how it is in the workouts of life. We're going to have workouts. You and I can be assured of that. We're going to be brought to times in which we're going to have to work things out in faith. And we're going to be brought to times where we know that God will work it out with us. Because God is not a God who's hidden from us. He was not a God who was hidden from Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, but he was right there with them in the midst of the fire. And people tell stories all the time of being in the midst of workouts in life and saying, "Let me tell you what, God was with me in the midst of it. And let me tell you what I discovered about myself and how I changed and how I deepened in my faith." See, those are stories of changed lives. And you've got those stories. Or if you don't really think you have that story, you just wait. Because you're going to have an opportunity. You're going to have an opportunity. And so it's hard to say, let's at least count the fires of life as good. But even the Apostle Paul in his pen said, even those difficult times are good when you're facing them with God. And they are for us as well. Lord, I don't know the fires that are in each of our individual lives. Some of us feel like right now, this fire in life is 7 times harder than anything we've ever gone through. But Father, in your own wonderful way, reveal to us, assure us, widen our faith to know that you're present, that you're with us, that you're always there. And that we never face the fire of refinement or the fire of adversity on our own. But we always face it with you as we invite you to reveal yourself to us. So Father, may that take place now for us. So that in our own lives emerges a story of how you've involved yourself in our hearts, in our lives, and how it's all worked out on the other side. Father, this is the prayer that we offer to you as we invite you to make yourself known to us. And it's in the loving name of your Son, our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, that we offer our prayer to you as together we say, Amen. This morning, our closing hymn is number 367, He Touched Me. And as we sing this song of invitation, I really invite you to think about those times of workout, of fire, of adversary in your life, when you felt like you were the bread in the middle of a pop-up toaster, knowing that God was the one who was faithful, who touched and transformed, and who brought you out. As we share in the song of invitation, I also invite you to become a part of this church family if you feel led to. We invite you to know Christ as Lord and Savior and join on your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, and to be baptized. Even next Sunday, you would be invited to be baptized, or to join on transfer of your membership from another church family. If you would like to be prayed, if you would like to spend time in prayer, the altar rail is here for you to be in a time of personal prayer, or if you'd like to be prayed with by one of us, if you'll simply just get our attention, it would be our privilege to pray with you. I invite you to stand and join with us as together we sing, He Touched Me. Chuck and Lee, I invite you, if you want to go outside and be there so when everybody comes, you're ready for them. We invite you to make your contributions to the ministry of the Gideons. And go now. There's so many things happening in the life of the church this week. We invite you to pray and to come and be a part of what you're able. And go in the knowledge that our God is a God who's faithful. Faithful in our past. Faithful in the fires and trials of life in the present. And He is faithful for our future. Our God is a God who's faithful. Please remember, you're called to be the church. And so you and I, we do not simply come to church. Who are we?
We're
called to be the church. That's right. So be the church. I messed that one up today. Right, have a great day.